Welcome to Oceanside, our hometown.
The year is 1968. I've just stopped by the Oceanside Police Department to alert Patrolman Matt Lyons about some suspicious smells that were coming from the Volkswagen Beetle that was parked next to me at last night's Valley Drive-In. Then I realize this building's vacant. The Valley Drive-In stopped showing films years ago, and it's 2005. However, Officer Lyons and his patrol car is still 1968, as they're making sure the history of Oceanside and the police department are never forgotten.
Walking through the halls of the Oceanside Police Department, looking at the photos of the men and women who've served before him, it is obvious that Corporal Matt Lyons is proud of the department's past.
Coming to Oceanside in 2000, it was important for me to know about the city, the community, and the people I was going to start policing. And so it was very natural for me to learn about the city so I could take ownership in the community.
Lyons just doesn't recognize Oceanside's history. He lives it, frequently wearing an old patrolman uniform and driving around in a 1968 Dodge Polaris squad car. He always thought about restoring an old police car, but it wasn't until June 13, 2001, that he got the incentive to actually do it. On that date, his partner, Tony Zepitella, was killed in the line of duty.
I had discussed it with my son and my daughter and my wife and so forth, and said it would be important for me to do something to honor Tony Zepitella, who's a good friend to many officers, a dedicated individual, and this was a good tool for me to do that so that I can give me a reason to talk about him so we don't forget.
The car's number is the most recognizable tribute.
The badge number Tony wore was 269. 269 is significant to most officers who work for the city of Oceanside. And then this car, of course, is honored with Tony's number so that we can honor Tony. And so when you go to a parade, you'll hear Tony's number and Tony's name.
After Zepitella's death, the police department erected a monument outside the station. It was to honor those officers that have given the ultimate sacrifice. Oceanside's first fallen officer dates back to the days of the horse and buggy, when the city's population was barely over 1,000. It occurred on July 4th, 1889, at what is now Pierview Way, when City Marshal Charlie Wilson tried to arrest cowboy John Murray.
John Murray is not going to have anything to do with it. He ends up drawing out his sidearm, shoots Charlie Wilson once. Charlie falls mortally wounded, thus marking time, the first falling officer for the city of Oceanside.
Law enforcement equipment has undergone drastic improvement since Wilson's death.
The only safety equipment or protection that a city marshal had during that time frame wouldn't have been much more than the star they wore on their chest, which here, of course, says city marshal, and empowers them and gives them the authority that the people entrusted them with. And that, of course, would be the sidearm that they carried on their side. And usually it was the choice of the weapon they were most comfortable with, this being just basically a .45 caliber peacemaker, the weapon that basically most of them would use to protect themselves. But relatively, they're out on their own.
While Officer John Mugen, Oceanside's other fallen hero, is buried at Mission San Luis Rey, no one is certain where Charlie Wilson's final resting place is. He was originally buried at Buena Vista Cemetery, along with many of the city's founding fathers.
Fast forward more than a century later, the Buena Vista Cemetery is long gone. In its place is Hunter's Steakhouse. All that remains of those buried here is this memorial plaque. Or so they'll have us believe.
One account was, I guess there was a guy working construction here. At some point they located another body after they was supposed to removed of all the decedents, and I guess they were actually buried down on the slope, and that was taken from a newspaper account from someone who actually worked on the site. So either way, I don't really know where Charlie Wilson is narrowed right now. He may have been reinterred at some point. I'm still researching that.
As the makeup of the city changed, so too did the police department, taking on new looks and responsibilities.
Okay, we're now with Corporal Matt Lyons in the front desk area of the current Oceanside Police Department. And tell us, Corporal, how has the front desk changed from the 40s and 50s to today?
You know, Robert, the police department, of course, years ago, talking the 40s and 50s, is back at 305 Nevada for the city of Oceanside, changed because we wouldn't necessarily have something this elaborate. You're talking, might have been as simple as a desk and maybe someone that answered the phone. It wouldn't necessarily have been like we have here. Years ago, obviously, there had been a police officer. Today, like we have right now, we've got a number of community service officers. There are people who are professional staff trained, the facility and the type of equipment they need to be prepared to handle various types of computer software and computer programs so that they can document these and triage and handle the barrage of calls that come through.
With the advent of separate divisions, locker room facilities, and senior volunteers, the station is a far cry from those of 50 years ago. In 2006, the department will unveil a new series of badges to commemorate the department's centennial anniversary.
Each of the officers will be wearing that during that anniversary year to help commemorate and hopefully connect each one of those officers to their heritage and their history.
As a rule, I try to stay out of the back of police cars as much as possible. When it comes to Corporal Lyons and a 68 Polara, I can make an exception, because we're not going back to the station. We're going back in time, honoring those men and women who sacrificed their lives for the good of the city. This is Robert Boyd reporting for Inside Oceanside.
If you're interested in starting your own business or need improvement in your current venture, the Small Business Development Center is here to help you.
I have a lady down in Solana Beach that's got a broken computer problem with her software email, so I'll head out there.
Oceanside entrepreneurs and small business owners interested in starting or improving their own business can look no further than to their own community for help.
Just to get started, what do you do first? Do you get a business license? Do you go file a DBA? Do you get a bank account? Are you going to be a corporation? Are you going to be a partnership? Are you going to be a sole proprietor? All those things are questions that you have to answer before you start, because if you do it wrong, it becomes more difficult to change later on down the road.
The Small Business Development Center, or SBDC, of North San Diego County, sponsored by MiraCosta College, is here for you.
Small businesses are the engine that drives the economy. In fact, more than half the national GDP and more than half of the jobs in the nation are created by small businesses. We at the Small Business Development Center believe that that small business engine needs fuel, and we provide some of the fuel that helps drive those engines.
I stumbled upon it, really. I didn't even know it existed, but I'm very glad that I came here, because we've been a source of tremendous amount of information. They helped me with my business plan. They helped me with securing a loan. They helped me with forecasting, projections, accounting, payroll, all the other elements of business.
Located in the heart of Oceanside, SBDC offers expert advice for business planning, finance, management, marketing, operations, and consulting.
The Small Business Development Center program is the largest federal program designed to help small business owners. There are 1,100 SBDCs, Small Business Development Centers, nationwide. And in San Diego County, there are two. One at Southwestern College, and the second one right here at MiraCosta College.
Since 1999, SBDC has seen and assisted almost 5,000 clients with their business. SBDC's business consultant, Joe Molina, offers consultations and small business workshops both in Spanish and English.
One of my main tasks is to meet with clients, interview clients, and see, help them on setting up their business or advance their business. And my other task is training. I set up the different workshops and trainings that happen at the SBDC.
I went over to the Small Business Resource Center at MiraCosta College, and they have some fantastic consulting services. Most of them are free. Some of them you have to pay for. They're well worth whatever you're going to spend on them.
Other types of services related to business assistance are offered at the Oceanside Public Library, the San Diego Chapter Society of Retired Executives, and the City of Oceanside's Economic and Redevelopment Department.
Things that you may not even think are related to your business are going to become important in a very short period of time, because the business is going to require you to do more things than just the job that you used to do. I worked with computers. I did a little bit of programming. I fixed systems. I built data centers. That's one of the things I do now, but I also do sales. I do marketing. I do financials. I have to put my money somewhere, either in a bank or some other sort of place to hold it.
Overall, before starting your own business, do your research, read business-related books, and attend some nuts and bolts seminars of small business.
The public library is an incredible resource for finding leads. The City of Oceanside has access to a database of companies where you can look up contacts and contact the people who are involved in the businesses in your area. And then another great resource is the Chamber of Commerce. If you start a business and you don't join the Chamber of Commerce, you're really missing out on meeting a lot of other small business owners that'll be interested in your services or can help you promote your business. The last thing that I would suggest that every small business owner gets involved in is a networking group. People are what make business work.
SBDC consultants and resources are available to the local Oceanside residents and small business owners in all areas of North San Diego County.
Something's brewing in North County and it ain't coffee. Microbreweries are the new rage in beer drinking, and North and San Diego counties are brewing up some of the best in the country. In fact, one of the top-rated breweries in the world is right here in North County.
RateBeer.com put out their Rate Beer Best of January 2004, and we were the number one rated brewery in the country and number three in the world. And you raised, wow.
Stone Brewing Company in San Marcos has risen to the top. CEO Greg Cook started this small business in 1996 with co-founder Steve Wagner. But how does one fall into the beer business?
Just out of sheer enthusiasm. In the late 80s, I had an epiphany. I discovered that beer could actually taste really great. Beyond that, it could be incredibly complex and rich and satisfying. I sometimes say I didn't choose beer, it chose me. But I found that the more that I learned about beer, the more I wanted to learn about beer.
And how does one learn about beer?
Yeah, beer research. That's just got a tough ring about it, doesn't it? Yeah, I slaved quite a bit. I really, there's a lot of self-sacrifice in my history there with my beer research.
He actually met his future business partner at a class at UC Davis called A Sensory Evaluation of Beer.
We just started talking, realized that we had complementary skill sets and experiences, and 3 years later, I'm making it sound easy, 3 years later, and a lot of, like, are we doing the right thing? We got to be nuts. But 3 years later, we decided to take that proverbial leap off the edge of the cliff and start Stone Brewing.
And are we glad they did. We decided to take this opportunity to get a little beer knowledge under our belts. Chris Cochran gave us a personal tour of the brewery.
Welcome to Stone Brewing Company. I'd like to show you around and show you how we make our world-class beers here at Stone. Everything starts here in our mill room, where we pull our two-row malt from the outside in. It's milled and mixed with our specialty malts to achieve the different flavor profiles and characteristics of each of our beers, whether it be Stone Pale Ale, Stone Smoked Porter, or Arrogant Bastard Ale. They all have different malts, different hops, the same water, and the same yeast. Those are the four ingredients, your water, hops, yeast, and barley. But everything starts here in our mill room, where we mill the grain in the mill room, and from there it is transferred up through this PVC pipe by the use of a large auger bit, or like a corkscrew, and transferred up the white piece of PVC and onto the grist bin. It's measured to a certain amount, a certain weight, and then it is transferred into the mash tun. From the mash tun, that's where it sits for about 4 hours, steeping in the hot water, where we're basically getting that starch and sugar out of the grain, leaving the spent grain as a byproduct, and transferring the wort into the kettle to where it will eventually be boiled. The kettle on the right is where basically everything starts to transform at that point. We add in the hops at that point. About 90 minutes it boils, and then after that point it is transferred into the whirlpool on the right, and then by the use of a cold water tank, we were able to chill the wort down from about 210 degrees to about 73 degrees. And then that wort at that temperature is introduced into the fermenters. The fermenters are all the conical shaped vessels you see behind me here. Inside those is an organism called yeast. And yeast is a wonderful organism. All it knows to do is eat starch and sugar and produce carbon dioxide and alcohol.
After the fermenters, the beer is filtered and knocked down to a chilly 37 degrees. Then it's either kegged or off to the bottling line, which can fill up to 220 bottles per minute.
Glad you guys can come by and check out Stone Brewing Company. People can come by for tours on Fridays and Saturdays. They can check us out at stonebrew.com. And cheers.
As you can see, Stone Brewing Company is truly a remarkable business. But we think what makes them so great is their honesty.
We like to, and I like to, express ourselves in the way we represent our beers in ways that are accurate, honest, straightforward, but also we don't pull any punches. When we write on the back of the Arrogant Bastard Ale bottle, questions or comments, if you don't like this beer, keep it to yourself. We don't want to hear from any sniveling yellow beer drinking wimps, because this beer wasn't made for you. We mean it. We're being honest.
And did we mention that Stone doesn't do any advertising? Guess they have a reason to be a little arrogant.
Something fishy is going on in the waters off Carlsbad. Scientists at the Hub SeaWorld Research Institute are running an aquafarm to raise and release over 300,000 fish per year.
Our goal is to get to between 300,000 and 350,000 fish a year released. That's for the white sea bass. The whole program started in the mid-80s as a stock enhancement program for sport fish off of the coast of California. We don't go and hunt our chickens and cows anymore. And we really do need to start looking at how we're hunting our fish. Environments just can't sustain the amount of protein from the sea that the globe needs now. And we need to move towards fish farming. It's the only real way that we can meet these needs.
This program is funded by a fishing stamp. When someone, a fisherman goes, buys his license, we'd like to think that fishermen are going to reap the rewards of our rehabilitating the fishery out there too. So it's unique in the sense that a lot of our volunteers are fishermen, and we benefit that community in that way. But as I mentioned too, we have environmental groups that help us out as well. And I mean, really, what I think this program has the potential to do is stand as almost a template on how to be proactive in rehabilitating a marine resource.
A team of scientists, researchers, and technicians is needed to breed, feed, and raise the fish until they're ready for release.
Our main focus here at the hatchery is to bring wild parental stock, or we call them brood stock, into the hatchery. And our job is to take those fish, give them the proper conditions so that they can reproduce in captivity, take the eggs, hatch the eggs, grow the larvae, get the fish to a size suitable for tagging, tag those fish, and get them into the ocean.
My position involves conducting research on white sea bass as well as other species. Primarily, we work with the larval stages. We've got several species of fish spawning. We are trying to learn how to rear the larvae and juveniles.
Inside the facility, four tanks filled with brood stock allow scientists to manipulate water temperature and light and trick fish into spawning throughout the year. Fish culturists maintain these tanks, regulate the fish's diet, and ensure the fish's survival.
Once they hit about 12 days old, we start feeding them a dry diet as well as a frozen diet. And the idea is to get them weaned onto the dry diet as quickly as possible. During that weaning process, fish become highly cannibalistic. So we have to go through the grating, and it's basically putting all the fish through a box with interchangeable bars, and the bars will sort the fish by size, and we try to get ahead of the cannibalism that way.
after fish are weaned, they're raised to adult size at one of 15 grow-out facilities along the California coast.
I supervise the 15 grow-out facilities that we have in this program. These facilities provide a chance for our fish to gain a bigger size and also disperse our release sites. You know, instead of just dumping all of our fish here in Carlsbad, it allows us to disperse our fish, you know, throughout the region. Each of our different grow-out facilities run by different volunteer groups. We estimate that we have over 20,000 volunteer hours a year put into this program. And without them, we couldn't run the grow-out facilities as we do, and we think they provide a really big benefit to our program in the sense that instead of releasing a little 3-inch fish, we're releasing a big, you know, 12, 14-inch fish into the wild, and there's not as many mouths out there that can feed on those bigger fish.
Everyone pulls together on release day to safely deposit fish in nearby waters and wave their goodbyes.
And typically we'll release them there at the site where they've been raised for a number of reasons. One, it's far less stressful on those fish to drop a net and have them swim away from a grow-out facility than put them in buckets or nets and transport them in a boat somewhere else. And we want to give them as big of a head start as they possibly can when they go out into the wild. We count all of the fish the day of the release, and it's kind of like a graduation day. All the volunteers that have come to help grow those fish for the past several months participate in counting the fish and sending them on their way. We also take final length and weight estimates of the fish so we know how big they were when they went out, and we scan them for their coated wire tags that we put in every fish. We don't want to release a group of fish that has, you know, low tag retention, because then if we recapture them down the line, we're not going to know that they came from our program.
When we get a tag back, and we can figure, okay, it was this 1,000 fish. We'll know where they were released. We'll know when they were released. We know how many fish were released at that time. We'll know how far that fish has moved from its release location. There's a lot of good biological information. So that's a big big component of this whole project, is by getting this data back. Not only are we learning things about how well our stock enhancement program, but we're also learning a little bit about the biology of the white sea bass. The method of measuring how well this program is doing is by recovering these tags. So we have sampling program that goes out and will actually gill net for small white sea bass. On a larger scale now, we're lobbying with the sport fishermen to please turn in your fish heads if you catch a white sea bass, because it's these legal fish and the tags that are in these legal fish are really going to begin to tell us how well we're doing.
The team at the Hubs SeaWorld Research Institute have released over 30,000 sea bass this year to help balance the environment and benefit recreational fishers.
By replenishing a white sea bass population, commercial fishermen may have more animals to catch and supply, but also we're benefiting the ecology. Anytime we have a species that's out of balance with the rest of the population out there, it's going to have a domino effect in other areas. So I think by us replenishing these wild stocks, we're helping balance the ecology back again, which I think benefits everybody in the long run in one way or another.
On, off, on, off. Clean water comes out with a flick of the wrist. There are people on our planet still dying from a lack of access to clean water, but we can count on it to pour out of our tap ready to drink. Is it magic? No. It's the result of a team effort. A team 140 people strong.
Oceanside's Water Utilities Department is busy 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, ensuring that we have clean, safe water.
The water originates for San Diego County, of course, from the Colorado and Northern California waters, are brought into Riverside County, where the Metropolitan Water District takes it and pipes it on down to San Diego County through huge pipelines. The Robert A. Weiss Water Filtration Plant that sits out here in San Diego County, east of Vista, actually is sitting right next to three of those pipelines. Oceanside is the first treatment plant along the line to take from that water supply. And a lot of people ask, why? Would you be located way out here east of Vista? Well, it's actually because we can take the pressure and the volume that comes off of those pipelines into our treatment plant to use it as part of the energy source that makes this plant so efficient and so well run.
Untreated or raw water is imported, as it's cost effective to treat it here at the Weis plant. The water comes in fast from the pipeline, is thoroughly mixed with coagulants, then run through a filter system 8 feet deep, like the natural process of a stream. Disinfectant is added, and then it goes to the 12 reservoirs in the city. Twice a day, a determination is made based on usage and conditions like weather to possibly change the amount of raw water ordered. Next, we went to the state-certified laboratory at the beautiful San Luis Rey wastewater plant and took a closer look at the testing process our water goes through.
The regulations are made, first of all, by the Environmental Protection Agency of the federal government. And then they're carried down to the state level, and the Department of Health Services enacts them at the state level. Starting back at the water filtration plant that we were at earlier, the testing is done on a continuous basis for certain parameters like turbidity, where they have automated analysis going, but they also do laboratory checks on those. And then we move toward testing that's done on a daily basis to test the mineral content of the water to see if it changes at all. We do weekly bacteriology tests, which is quite interesting because they go to 31 locations throughout the city. At their fixed locations. They're little tan risers that you'll see located sporadically across the city. And what that tells us is what happens to the water after it leaves the filter plant, goes to reservoirs, then goes out into the system. That's to make sure that the water is still of high quality.
With a lab on site here, they can have their data a lot of times within one day. Whereas if we had to send the samples out to a commercial laboratory, a lot of times it takes weeks to get the data back. So it would really be impractical for operational control for that type of timeline.
The equipment in the new lab is impressive and put to good use. A new machine, an inductively coupled plasmonic spectrometer, has plasma inside at a temperature of 9,000 degrees. When water samples are injected, certain elements burn in different colors, enabling detection of any toxic elements lurking in our water like lead, mercury, or arsenic. In 1994, the Mission Basin Groundwater Purification Facility opened as a result of the drought and our continuing dependency on imported water. Five wells, with plans for more, pump up brackish groundwater, treat it through a complex desalting process, and then it goes into the system, earning Oceanside a nice little rebate.
In the event of some problem due to like earthquake or some problem in the system where the county was shut off either by the Metropolitan Water District's aqueducts or the county's aqueducts, this would be the only water that we would have for the citizens of Oceanside. This is roughly right now is 9% of our daily needs, daily supply, daily demand. That's one reason why we're expanding it. We're trying to get it up to maybe 20%. Enough to get us through any emergency.
I had to ask about bottled water.
We're testing our water more than they test bottled water. So our water has more safety security built into it than bottled water. If you're going to go to a game, you want to take a bottle of water with you, that's reasonable to buy bottled water. Buy bottled water to drink at home for all your purpose. You're really wasting your money. You're creating a huge pollution problem with all those plastic bottles. You know, bottled water is a good idea for emergency storage as long as you cycle it.
What about training for a career in water treatment?
Palomar College actually offers training. You can work for an AA degree out there, but a part of an AA degree that you can get is a certificate in water treatment that will be part of that is AA degree. So they have a real good program out there.
A continuous supply of clean, safe water for Oceanside is the overriding concern. There are ongoing discussions about the proposed landfill at Gregory Canyon and its possibility of polluting the San Luis Rey River. In addition, there's growing demand for Colorado River water from other states, which also bears attention. In the meantime, conservation of our most precious resource is also very important.
It's very important that folks conserve water all the time. We really don't have an unlimited supply in Southern California. Again, we're a desert region. We don't have an unlimited supply on Earth.
Hi, I'm Allie Santa Anna. Surfing is a large part of the Southern California lifestyle. Although it originated elsewhere, surfing has deep roots right here in Oceanside. Surfing has come a long way since its inception, and some significant landmarks in surfboard manufacturing have taken place in Oceanside. The locals have committed themselves to preserving surf history, as well as taking full advantage of new surf technology. So come with me on a journey from the beginnings of surfboard manufacturing into the future. Our first stop is the California Surf Museum, a place that devotes itself to educating the public about the sport of surfing. They had all the resources to give us the facts on the origin of the surfboard.
The California Surf Museum is Oceanside's second largest tourist attraction. It blows us away. I mean, this is an honor to be such a vital part of Oceanside's tourism. And we invite all locals to come and see the surfing museum. The California Surf Museum is out there for people to enjoy and learn about the history of surfing. Surfing, it's new in the United States. It came to California in 1907, and we have a couple of surfboards here in the center of our display that are approximately 100 years old, and we're very proud to have these boards. We have a board that used to be owned by Duke Hanamoku, who was the ambassador of surfing to the world. He was an excellent Olympic swimmer. He competed in four different Olympics and won medals in the swimming events in each one. And everywhere he traveled throughout the world, he took his surfboard. So he would often give it away as a gift. If he saw that little spark in your eyes, he'd give you his surfboard. Then you had a prototype. You and your buddies could make one or another. And he could go back and make another one. I mean, that's the way surfboard manufacturing was in the earliest times. You made your own boards.
As technology and materials improved, surfing became a worldwide industry. By the 1960s, surfing was so popular that for some local surfers, board shaping went from being a hobby to a successful career. One local family-owned shop, Whitlock Industries, specializes in making contemporary custom fiberglass boards.
We make everything from the longboards, the shortboards, to fun boards that are high performance, custom made, professional boards that are made for professional athletes that we consider them disposable toys. They last about 6 weeks and then they're done. And then we'll also make them from the beginner to the intermediate to the advanced.
On a custom surfboard, what I do is I get with the customer and I first of all, I kind of foursquare that customer. You know, how tall are they? You know, what is their surfing? How long have they been surfing? What is their surfing ability? Are they a beginner? Are they advanced? Are they intermediate? Where are they going to be surfing at? And what type of surfing do they want to do? Do they want to ride long boards? Do they want to ride a mid-size board? Or do they want a short board? So going through those things, I get down to what's going to really be ideal for that particular surfer. There's so many variations of surfboard designs going on right now. A lot of girls are coming into the surfing world now. So we make a surfboard that's geared it's geared for a girl. There's certain features that a girl likes in a surfboard that a guy doesn't. It's just fantastic. There's so many variations of shapes for the market today that's making it real exciting.
Tom Morey has taken technology to the next level with a new board development called the Swizzle Surfboard. Tom and longtime pal Chuck craft these reliable boards from their Oceanside shop, Y Surfboards.
Got a degree in mathematics, and I started wanting to repair my own board and then to modify my own board. And this came from some gut place. I had ideas about how to reshape, and I thought at first that perhaps surfboards in the 50s were ideally suited for everybody and that they were perfectly shaped. And then realized, well, that would be absurd in this short time that everything's all figured out. So I started coming up with ideas that could make a difference. I came up with an idea to turn the nose down the tip of the board so that if and when you went through the water would go over that front part and lift it. And that worked out very good, and almost all surfboards for quite a long time had that feature.
I heard about the swizzle stick. I read about it in the Union Tribune.
My friend and I have been looking for a board that would be lightweight, easy to paddle, when it bumped us, it wouldn't hurt us. And when I read about this in the Union Tribune, I searched Oceanside and I found the company. And we came in and we tried the boards out, and they were lightweight, they were easy to turn, easy to move, and easy to paddle. So we bought them.
What we've done as a result of the 30 years of experience with boogie boards is we've applied these same materials that are used in the boogie board for the exterior, so that you got a lot of stiffness, and yet you got the safety, so that instead of what happens with hard boards, regular surfboards that are like that when they hit you, they could hit, they would be like this. Now we make your board a little narrower in the middle instead of keeping these boards wider in the center, so they look like surfboards that have been made in the past. We pinch them in a little bit like the parabolic skis.
With all these new advancements, the future of surfing is unlimited. The industry is thriving and shows no signs of slowing down.
It is such a pure sport. It's a person out in the waves on that wave search looking for the best ride of their life. There's a challenge there that appeals to the human spirit, and that will stay with us forever. No matter what type of material is under your feet, you're still looking for that quality experience and ride, and that will be with us forever.
I mean, who knows where it could all go as far as there's probably going to be some kind of a motorized surfboard eventually in a Jetson type world, you know.
You'll never take the handcraftedness out of it. That's what's unique to surfing. I think the future of surfboards is going to be, obviously the machinery and computers are really going to help with the production of the boards, but you're still going to have the hand-shaped one of samples that get produced, and you're going to still need the team rider and the shaper feedback. That's a very key factor when you're making a surfboard. The next thing that we're going to see is probably more the materials that are used, the foams, the resins, the glassing procedures. All of that it's been doing it the same way for the last 100 years, and I foresee it starting to change and starting to with more environmental friendly chemicals and that kind of stuff, hopefully down the road.
Surfing is a sport and lifestyle that is a permanent part of the California culture. Its unique blend of old traditions and new technology make it truly an exceptional sport.
What makes surfing great in Oceanside are the waves. Oceanside is good year-round. You get south swells, west swells, north swells. It breaks in all conditions. It's one of the most consistent spots in Southern California. You can always come to Oceanside and always find a wave to surf, whether it's the harbor, the pier, Tyson, Oceanside Boulevard. There's always somewhere to surf in Oceanside. It is becoming the new surf town. I foresee this place as being the next Huntington Beach in the next 3 to 5 years. And it has a big influence, and there's a lot of surfers that do come from Oceanside.
Oceanside is rich in surfing history, and we want to encourage you to pick up a board and get out in the water.
It's often been said that the pursuit of excellence is lonely at the top. The same can be said if you're leading the pack.
Just ask AJ Acosta, a junior here at El Camino High School, labeled as the fastest 11th grader in the United States. AJ finds himself leading the pack so often these days that his conquests consist of beating the course record and his own personal best.
His mother admits that AJ is not a chip off the recent block.
If you just look at me or my husband, you can see that we're two of the most unathletic people you've ever want to meet. So it's, I think it was maybe from an ancestor like 1,000 years ago. No one in my family is athletic.
His father admits that his own lack of athletic prowess as a teenager makes watching AJ even more special.
When I watch AJ run, I have a sense of pride that I'm sure other fathers have had before. But for me, it's special, mainly because I've never really been an athlete, and he is such an outstanding athlete. And I know when he goes on and takes the field, he's very friendly with all the runners and congenial, shakes their hand. When the gun goes off, He doesn't care who's ahead of him or behind him. He's going to do his best to pass him.
Watching AJ pass the competition and take the lead is his mentor and coach, Tom Close. This El Camino alumni is a competitive runner himself who placed in the top 10 during the 2003 United States Championships before being sidelined with a fractured hip. His experiences taught him what ingredients are necessary for top competition.
AJ is a special runner. I'm going to steal from Mark Wetmore, University of Colorado coach. He talks about four talents. There's basic speed, basic endurance, mental toughness, and durability are the four main things any runner has to have. And I've had some good runners in the last few years that have had two, maybe three of those talents, but AJ scores high in all four of them, and that's where he's really going to make that jump to the next level and be a superstar down the road.
AJ has his own take, however, on why he leads the pack.
I'm really competitive, so if I see someone playing a sport and they're doing better than me, then I have to do better no matter what, even if it's in like bingo or something. I'm competitive in bingo. I know it sounds bad, but it's just the way I am.
Coach Close agrees that competitive drive is an essential force for success.
It really has to be a personal affront to you to have somebody beat you in a race, and you got to take it very, very personally. And AJ definitely embodies that, and you see it in his races that he's really offended anytime someone is in front of him.
It's this same competitive drive that makes him stand out in other arenas as well.
My proudest moment at El Camino has probably been, it actually hasn't been in running, it's been at the basketball games when we get, you know, the huge crowds going and, you know, we just get like a defense cheer and the whole crowd just goes crazy.
But it's not only in the sporting arenas in which AJ is a public figure, but in the classroom as well. Every Wednesday at lunchtime, AJ leads other politically minded teens on a variety of controversial topics.
The Armchair Quarterbacks Politicians, it was formed by myself, Jason Wyman, and Brett Johnson. And we started it just as a sort of parody of some sorts to mock the election and just to get different people's views. Some issues we debate would be maybe abortion or euthanization, stem cell research, pizza versus Chinese takeout, anything of that sort.
These varied interests all have a place in AJ's future.
I'd like to be a history teacher and coach also like Tom, but in college I want to learn some exercise physiology so I can learn, you know, what's the most efficient stride going uphill, or, you know, what's the most efficient way to just run around the track.
Something that AJ is already doing quite well. Yet, as his junior year comes to an end, AJ sets his sights on a short-term goal as well.
In high school, my goal would be to run a sub-4 mile. That's, you know, not many high schoolers have done that. Only four have done it. And so to do that would be really cool. But to win a state championship, that's my top priority right now.
His coach sees AJ's only limitations being the lack of regional competition.
I think the competition he has to look forward to is really down the road. As a high school athlete, the competition is somewhat limited in your structure. I mean, you can only race whoever's in this area, whoever's in San Diego. He has a few opportunities to go outside of San Diego and race some top-level competition. But really, for someone like AJ, the true competition is going to come down the road in the college scene. And hopefully, if things go well, he'll still be running after college and at an international level. And I think that's where the true competition lies for him.
It's a goal that his father dreams of as well.
I think this might be every father's dream, that someday I may hear his name announced at the Olympics.
But for his mother, every race is a heart-pounding adventure.
When I watch my son run, my heart just stops. I hold my breath as he's going around the track until the finish line.
We can all breathe easy, though, knowing that this wildcat is going places.
If AJ's pursuit of excellence feels lonely at times, it's only a temporary situation. Once he crosses that finish line, his momentary isolation becomes a cheering ground to supportive fans. You can count on me as one of them. I'm Benjamin Granite for Inside Oceanside.
High school years are usually filled with friends and Friday night football, first jobs and first crushes. But for teen moms, high school years are very different.
I always thought that I wasn't gonna have kids until I was like way older, like 30, I said. But it didn't happen that way.
Es bonito tener una bebé, pero también es mucha responsabilidad.
Well, I didn't want to have it actually.
but after that I was happy, so it was okay.
The demands of growing up quickly and becoming a mother can be overwhelming. Now, young moms are given a second chance
at Vista Community Clinic.
When we first meet the client, we talk about different needs and we develop a plan, and they come up with their own plan. I think that's why we have more participation. Definitely when you have somebody come to you and tell you what you need, it doesn't work as well as when somebody comes to you and says, what can I do for you?
That having a baby is a big responsibility. I have help from the Second Chance program and from my mom, so I'm doing okay.
Well, we serve girls ages 12 to right before their 19th birthday who are getting their prenatal care at the clinic. So that usually encompasses the North County area.
Well, at first they come a little bit withdrawn. They don't talk. And the children are the same way. But as they keep coming and the moms start talking with the other girls, and they become friends, you know, slowly. And I think that's good because they found a support network.
If you need any type of help, go to them, because, I mean, in anything, like if you have any relationship problems with your mom or with your boyfriend, just go to the Second Chance program, because they can help you out in any way possible. They can give you very good advice.
The Second Chance program offers a variety of support services that include home visits, educational classes, nutrition consultations, and support groups.
Some girls, it's doing a career and pursuing that. Other girls, it's learning about parent education. So we do the physicals and immunizations, for sure, since we have the clinic right next to us, so we follow up on that. We also try to help out with the kids in the support group. And the home visitation, it's basically just a needs assessment, and whatever they're needing at that time, we follow up. So we might be following up on a school referral or getting the child an early head start. So it just varies from each girl.
They support you in anything. I mean, they have classes for you to come, and you learn more different things. Like, I learned how to actually properly put a car seat in a car, because I never did it the right way, I guess.
They give us classes about discipline, safeties, and everything. And that helped me a lot because, like, I'm young and I don't know a lot of about babies.
The Second Chance program at the Vista Community Clinic supports young moms and their families to help build a stronger community.
We see some families that struggle a lot with that at the beginning. And then as they have to, they just get all the emotions out and they get over it, then they realize, well, there's nothing I can do but be supportive with my child and make sure that I give them what they need. And so when that happens, it's beautiful.
They give her information, my mom especially, and it's a bill help her a lot. Questions my mom have about me.
When we have people, healthy families, they volunteer more. If they have better jobs, of course, they will be able to support each other financially. We don't have to think about that. So I think it's a big benefit to everybody. It definitely makes a difference.
What I think is very important to know about Second Chance is that we don't judge the girls. They are being judged constantly because some of them are 13, 14, and they're pregnant, they have children. And it's hard for them to be judged in that way, even though they're really good mothers. So I think it's important to understand, you know, where they are at and to not judge them, but listen to them instead.
These are girls who are facing a lot. They're not your typical teenager who has all the same friends. The typical teenager might be making bad remarks about them. And you just have to grow up a lot faster. And when they do, and they realize, hey, I can take care of my child, and I'm doing a great job at it, and they're very healthy, it gives you the confidence. And then we try to support them and say, you know, not only can you be a great mom, but you can also do this. And that's what we like to see them tackle on another project and succeed at it.
These young moms have learned a lot. They have many things to teach their children, and maybe even a few things to teach us.
Lo primero que yo, lo que no me, no se case joven, que estudie, que crezca sanamente, y que tenga un futuro bonito. Uh-huh.
keep the other half of the class. Okay, Mrs. Carroll and Dawn. Carol is one of my oldest students.
I think she's a little bit longer.
Not the
oldest.
Anyway,
I'm not the oldest.
Well,
I started here about 30 years ago.
Yeah, when I was a kid.
Engineers, lawyers, and teachers step away from their 9-to-5 jobs and come to a space where they can create art.
How much more is this than that?
This is twice as big as that.
Not three.
No.
It's a third.
It's a third. That's what I'm trying to tell you.
Up until the time I found this, I would typically work a 10 to 12 hour day. I was a workaholic. It afforded me an opportunity to look forward to the weekends where I could actually be a little bit more creative.
I just think everyone's doing the same thing, which is basically enjoying themselves and trying to create something that they've never been able to create before. And they do.
Oh, it nourishes me. It nourishes my heart. I never thought of myself as an artist and played around with different mediums, and I just found this is a medium that just resonates with me completely.
A lot of my friends find it somewhat a little bit mystifying that I had the ability to be able to make something as an artistic art form as well as to do my work as an engineer.
With an appreciation for sculpture but no art training, Sid took a leap and began to sculpt under the direction of master sculptor Tony Amato.
I started collecting art, and as a result, kind of got attracted probably about 10 years ago, 10 or 15 years ago, to stone carving. I came out here on one Saturday, told him I had no artistic background, I really hadn't done much, but had an appreciation for art. And he got me started, and it was one of those things that I just fell in love with, had a little bit of a knack for, and just ended up getting involved.
Tony Amato begins training students to use chisels, then advances instruction as students show aptitude. He instructs students on shaping, filing, sanding, and polishing until they have all the skills to make a final piece.
The ability to do is to start at the very basic. He has a real gift and a real knack to address people of different skills. He can take somebody who has no artistic background, no skill level, like I was when I got here. I could barely draw a straight line.
Students work in alabaster or marble to sculpt three-dimensional designs with width, height, and depth in mind. They begin with a drawing or model, then translate the design into the stone, which can weigh more than a ton.
It's a little easier in concept if you think that when somebody's painting, they're basically painting in two dimensions, hoping that they can see the third dimension. But when you're dealing in stone, that third dimension is the element that you have to capture.
When you're looking at anything that's three-dimensional, it should change from every 300 degrees around, 360 degrees around.
Tony Amato has been sculpting for over 35 years. He has worked with rock even longer. His father carved tombstones. Tony learned the craft and also learned to see something more in rocks.
I always wanted to take these tombstones and just bend them and turn them and twist them the way I want. And he always thought I was playing around. He always said, you got to get serious. And I guess I never did. Anyway, here I am. 70 years later.
Playing with the color of the stone in an imaginative shape, artists extract the beauty from ordinary looking rocks.
This is an orange stone that gets really beautiful when it's polished up. This is an abstract wave. I've worked mainly in ocean life, so I've done whales and walrus and seals.
The Amato Stone Carving Studio, run by Tony Amato, allows sculptors to drop in 1 to 3 days a week and work on projects at their own pace. A dinner bell brings artists together for snacks and lunch and gives them time to share ideas, jokes, and inspiration.
When most people should just do it, and that's the main thing with art, it's just what you do.
These sculptures, carved out of rocks thousands of years old, will remain as legacies for others to appreciate for generations.
That I could actually leave something behind that would have my name connected with it, that somebody would say, wow, this piece was made by somebody named Sid Harris.
Soroptimus International, the Historical Society of Oceanside, Ocean's 11 Casino. Contestants from all over gather to compete. Some have been called extremely focused, overly competitive, and outright psychotic. Their mission? To raise funds for the Oceanside Public Library. Their calling? To win the prize wooden seagull in the 13th annual Trivia Bee.
A big fundraiser. It's been the Friends' major fundraiser for a long, long time.
There've been some lean years too, but for the most part, it's made some bucks.
It's a lot of fun. Yeah.
I think there's other teams that are really eager to take the Seagull Trophy away from the North County Times this year. So we'll see if anyone's successful.
Yeah.
Tri-tip sirloin, quarter chicken, baked beans.
And these are his beers, and he's going to get in a car after this is over.
I just go park in the KLGT parking lot. What the heck?
We have beer and more beer and a little bit of wine for our country western theme.
Our strategy to win, stay sober.
Are you guys ready to play and have a good time? All right. Let the game begin.
I love your hairstyle.
Thank you.
We have Soroptimus here. We have a high school here. We have Rotary back here. And together, we really know that we can make a difference.
Do you have any good answers?
Question number one. The original Western Heritage Museum in Los Angeles was founded by which singing cowboy in 1988? Does the winner of the Indianapolis 500 auto race traditionally drink in the victory lane? The answer to the question is milk.
What is the New York Stock Exchange's ticker symbol for the biotech firm Genentech Incorporated?
That's not a science question.
Four states that meet at the U.S.
This year's
13th annual trivia bee is the Dusty Jackets.
We've been preparing for this all of our lives, watching hours and hours of mindless television and listening to countless meaningless records and reading some really senseless books, right?
Thank you for watching Oceanside, Our Hometown. To see more behind-the-scenes stories about Oceanside's people, places, and events, watch Inside Oceanside Monday through Friday on Channel 19.